Or?
The stuff that shall be.
Yes, my question about the paper, how long did you say the paper has to be? Is it a certain amount of pages or is it?
Oh, yeah, it's our Gordon rule thing. So the minimum for Gordon rule is 2,000 words. And it's 250 words per standard page. That's, you know, single space, sorry, double space, normal margins, and the usual 12-point font.
Okay.
So.
Double space?
Yep, because it's turned electronically, so, you know, saving paper.
Right.
It's, or you can single space it if you want. Okay. Basically, double space is easy to read, plus it looks bigger.
Right.
Something I've learned myself. Okay, anything else? Okay, so last time we went over the start of the apology, looked at the paper, and we saw that the paper's got how many parts?
Four.
Yeah, four. Which are the
intro,
summary.
Argument.
Yep. And which is the toughest part?
Argument.
Yeah, probably the argument. Oh, yeah, all good answers. Okay, so now we turn to the rest of the apology. Now, Socrates, he was on trial, he's been faced with the charge of being a corrupter. He responds back with a horse trainer analogy in order to try to refute the charge that he is the only corrupter. Then he gets Melius to modify the charge again to claim that he is an intentional corrupter, and the unintentional argument, he thinks, shows that he's not. Then he turns to sort of tormenting the court from the standpoint of being found innocent, not a great strategy. So what does he say? Well, we saw back in the introduction to this that the reason Socrates is there is because, well, why does he show up? I mean, he's not like locked up and dragged to his trial. He just kind of saunters up to the trial, sits out there waiting, you know, walks in willingly, without, you know, being handcuffed or being the police. So what's his moral reason for showing up? Well, he said he
doesn't want to be exiled.
Oh, he shows up because he said he would. He gave his word to the state, and he said, you know, he's going to obey because he lived at Athens all his life. He could have left anytime he wanted to, packed up his stuff, but he says he's going to go there because he agreed to obey. Now, they do probably consider offering him, you know, basically the chance to just, you know, try. And just like either they probably said to him, Socrates, you know, we really don't want to kill you, really don't want you to, you know, put you on trial, blah, blah, blah. So if you just stop doing what you're doing, then it'll be okay. Now, Socrates refuses to do so. And he says he would refuse to do so even if they told him to stop. Now that seems to contradict his view about going along with the state, because he said by remaining there he agrees to obey the laws. So what would justify him, you know, saying, no, if you tell me that I'm to stop, I won't stop, even if I'm offered freedom? Well, anybody ever see the old movie The Blues Brothers, Dan Aykroyd and the guys who did? A classic movie. Fortunately, thanks to Netflix, a lot of classics are still around. But it's still pretty old, so you probably haven't seen it. But their justification for what they were doing was they were on a mission from God. That's one of the lines from the movie, or a mission from God. And Socrates sees himself as being on a mission from the gods. And of course, the gods have higher authority than the state. And so he sees being a philosopher as a mission from the gods. Because, you know, because he was told by his friend that he is the wisest, and he's going to do what he does. Now, one fun fact about Socrates is that he says, and you'll see in the dialogue, that he claimed to hear voices in his head. Now, normally if someone hears voices, is that good or bad?
Bad.
Yeah, why is that bad? Yeah, because it's a little crazy. And usually, when you think of voices in people's heads, what are the voices telling them to do? Yeah, usually bad stuff. So normally, if someone says, I hear voices in my head, you're like, whoa. You generally don't see that in a lot of, like, you know, online dating profiles. You know, Interesting fact about self. I hear lots of voices in my head when I'm alone. Probably not a great appealing thing. Or maybe it is. Who knows? Now, interestingly, Socrates' voice didn't tell him to do bad stuff. It did the opposite. He believed that his voice warned him about things that were bad. And so what he would do, he would listen to his voice, and whenever he was about to do something that was a bad decision, his voice would always warn him and say, you shouldn't do that. And he says later on, his voice doesn't stop. So he's basically saying in the court, the little voice in my head tells me I'm doing fine, so I'm going to keep on going. Now, interestingly, this takes us a bit out of the apology. Interestingly, a lot of people hear voices that don't tell them to do bad stuff. In fact, you know, it's part of popular culture. You know, people talk, you know, everyone's seen the picture of, if you're trying to make a choice between good and evil, what role they show sitting on someone's shoulders. Yeah, you're a little angel, you're a little devil. And people hold conversations with themselves, and people often do talk about, you know, the voice of their conscience. And there was a New York Times bestselling book a while ago by a woman whose father heard voices, but they were the good kind. They always told them to do good stuff, like eat your broccoli, exercise, be nice to your kids, you know, kind of voices that you'd want to hear. And she mentioned, you know, unsurprisingly mentioned Socrates. So maybe there's a lot of people who hear voices in their head telling them to do good things. And you generally don't hear about them because good things don't get on the news, typically. You don't typically hear, person helps out people today, person is kind today. It's always something terrible, you know. So probably that's why we think that voices are always bad. So he's on a mission from God, and the little voice in his head tells him, you know, well, actually doesn't say anything, so he knows the voice doesn't say stop, so he keeps on going. Now, in terms of explaining why he's doing what he's doing, he brings up another analogy to horses. And this is it's a horse analogy, but not a horse trainer analogy. And he claims that he is the gadfly to the horse of the state. And the analogy, here's how it works. Socrates is the fly. The state is the horse. And what he does is, when the horse is, you know, just wants to lay there and be, you know, not do what it's supposed to, the gadfly bites it, makes it, you know, get up and go about its business. So metaphorically speaking, Socrates claims that what he does to the government is that he kind of, when they're not doing what they're supposed to, he kind of bites at them. And so they're forced to, you know, do their jobs. Now today, jumping ahead to now, who is supposed to be the gadfly that doesn't let the state get away with stuff and kind of, you know, bites at it when it does stupid or bad stuff? Well, who does President Trump hate? Oh, sorry, that's too broad of a question. What is one of the main things he hates?
FBI.
Yeah, he hates the FBI, the DOJ. Yeah, and in part, they're supposed to keep an eye on stuff. Also,
Congress.
Yeah, he hates them. They're supposed to keep an eye on the president, you know, check and balance. Also, the
press.
Yeah, the press, the media. You know, lying CNN, failing New York Times. Because part of their job, supposedly, in a free society, is to keep an eye on people in power and expose their misdeeds, like in Watergate, Whitewater, and the whole collusion thing. Now, Socrates thinks that that's really important and really good. And he says that the rulers, far from being mad at him, should be grateful, because he's correcting their misdeeds. And if Socrates wasn't dead and he was around today, and if he was being interviewed, he'd probably say, well, you know, Trump and other politicians should be grateful for the CNN, New York Times, because if they call them on their misdeeds and their mistakes and their lies, well, they should want to be honest. They should want to tell the truth. They should want to do a good job, and they should be grateful they're being corrected. Here's an analogy. Suppose you're, another one, not what Socrates uses, but suppose you want to be a really good tennis player. Would you want a coach that would just lie to you and tell you you're just always great, everything you do is great, Or would you all want to be honest about your faults?
Honest.
Yeah, because if they don't tell you what you're doing wrong, will you ever get better? No, because good coaches are, you know, critical. Not like terrifying, abusive, but, you know, critical. They tell you, and that's good, because if you want to be good at what you do, you would welcome, you know, yeah, criticism. You, I mean, you don't want people like, you know, trolling you or insulting you, but you would want, you know, correct criticism. And it's only people who, you know, Socrates argues, it's only people that are doing wrong that would not want to be corrected, because they just want to stick to their misdeeds. And so he says they should be grateful. So that raises two questions. One, should people in power, even minor positions of power, should they be grateful for criticism? Yeah, if they want to do their job correctly, they should, you know, if they're screwing something up, they should, you know, say thank you that, you know, it was, you know, doing something wrong. Of course, there's also the question of, are they grateful? Do they give a thank you press? Did Harvey Weinstein say thank you press? I was a, you know, assaulter and, you know, pervert and terrible, and you have called me out. I am so grateful for what you have done. No, typically not. I mean, in few rare cases, some people are. They're glad that someone called them and stopped them, but in general, no. People are doing terrible stuff, generally want to do the terrible stuff in secret, never get called out. Which is why I think, you know, Socrates, if he was alive today, he'd probably be a strong component of a, you know, free and strong, you know, press, and, you know, in order to keep a check on people in power, so that when they would do what they're supposed to. And again, not to just like tear into them stupidly, but to make sure they do what they're supposed to do. Now, he then turns to an interesting question that anybody who believes in causes has to consider, which is this. Suppose you really deeply believe in a political overall cause. Should you go into politics, you know, and then become, you know, like a representative, maybe run for senator and president someday? Or are you better off staying out of the system? And it's something, you know, that you might imagine people have debated since we've had political systems. Now, on one hand, what's to be gained by actually getting that power, that authority? Yeah, you get influence. You can actually do, you know, do stuff. You can, you know, be on committees, vote, and so forth. Now, on the downside, though, Socrates points out, well, this is kind of extreme. He claims, at least in, you know, his time, if you're going to fight for the right, you got to stay out of public station. Now, in his time, of course, they're more prone to, like, killing people, because they don't kill Socrates. But it is, you know, laying aside, like, the killing part, which we don't do so much anymore. The idea being is that you'd be more effective not being in office. Interestingly, the great political philosopher Sarah Palin, when she resigned as governor of Alaska, she made this exact argument. And I was watching and I was like, holy crap, she's going full Socrates right on national TV. Because she said that she couldn't do what she wanted to do within the office of the governor. She needed to be, you know, out of political office in order to do what she needed to do. Which apparently was being on Fox and then fading away into obscurity and being the subject of, you know, lame philosopher's jokes. Now, but are there good reasons to stay out of the public eye if you want to be like a real influencer? Yeah, what would be a reason? What can you do if you're not like in office? Well, what have you ever heard of, like, the Koch brothers or George Soros? He's like the left version of the Koch brothers. Yeah, what are those guys known for? It's not a minute coat. That's what I thought first. It's gone for the money. They're, I mean, they're billionaires. And what they can do is just dump, you know, millions of dollars on any election they see fit to, you know, to influence. And there are people like, well, if you follow like the legal, all the arrests of, you know, Trump's, you know, people, you can see that they, a lot of them are influence makers and peddlers, and they don't actually, most of them don't hold offices. They're outside of, you know, public office, but they're able to do a lot of stuff. So a case could be made that if you really want to have power in politics, you're better off being outside of public office, because you perhaps have less restrictions and are less risk. Because although you could be voted out of office, can you be voted out of being a billionaire? Mm-hmm. Yeah. So someone like Koch or Soros, they don't have to rely on being elected by the masses. They can use their money and influence, you know, throughout all the elections in all the states. So it is kind of an interesting question. There's also sort of a final point here. One worry is when people go, well, here's an example of Washington. Trump said he was going to go to Washington and drain the swamp. So how'd that work out? How are the alligators doing in Washington?
Pretty fine.
They're doing fine. They're doing great. All the alligators are sitting in their swamp saying, it's so nice, so swampy, so much money. Yeah, so he may have really intended to do that. He might have gone in thinking, I'm going to, you know, kick out all these, you know, swamp gators. But once you get in the swamp, what often do you find? You might be like, wow, I got scales. I'm an alligator too. This swamp is super sweet. Hanging out here with all my alligator buddies. So one concern is once people get into office, they become kind of assimilated into power. I mean, to go back to President Obama. In 2008, I remember well the days of 2008, people were super excited when Obama was elected because they thought he was going to do well. Yeah, hope and change. He's going to change the world. But to be honest, did he bring about as much change as people hoped for?
No.
I mean, he did a good job. I mean, because he pulled us out, you know, the economy was on fire, going off a cliff, and into a bigger fire during an earthquake and a volcano, and keep onto the Titanic. So he pulled us out of that. But the expectations people had for social justice, economic inequality, racism, etc., they didn't, you know, end up coming to pass. And what some critics have said is, you know, one view is he just was opposed by Congress. The other view is that once you get into office, of course, you're limited in what you can do, and also you become kind of part of the system. And so it is an interesting point, especially if you're radical in your views and you want to really, truly drain the swamp and change things. There's a question of, can you become part of the system and still be able to change the system, or does it change you? So Socrates finishes his defense, and they put it to a vote. And the way the trial worked was, well, our jury trials are similar in this way. What they would do is they would just like we do now, they vote. And Socrates ends up being found guilty. Now the second phase of the trial is a bit different from the way trials work today. The second phase is the sentencing part, but here's the difference. The accuser proposes a penalty. The defendant also proposes a penalty, and then the jury votes on that. So then they would decide which penalty to impose. So Meletus, of course, wants Socrates to be put to death. Although he probably didn't really want Socrates to be put to death, he probably wanted Socrates just to just go away. And so he put like the most extreme penalty, hoping Socrates would pick exile and just go away. So Socrates starts off basically antagonizing him. So he says, well, what should my penalty be? And the prytaneum was where they would put the Olympic athletes after their great victory. So what he said to do, well, my penalty was, you know, send me there. It'd be like today if someone, you know, was found guilty of a crime, they said, well, okay, my penalty would be this. You'll put me up in a 5-star hotel, give me a Tesla car, and $1 million a month. Well, I think that would be a sufficient penalty. I will be punished. Now, does that seem like a real punishment? No, because that's literally the highest award possible. And so naturally, they were pretty antagonized by that. And so his friends are like saying, what are you doing, Socrates? Offer to pay a fine. And Socrates says, you know, basically says, well, I've got a couple pennies in my pocket. I can pay those. And his friend's like, oh, Socrates. And so they basically pull all their money and offer to pay, you know, a substantial fine. Now, it might have gone at that. They might have been willing to say, okay, you're going to pay the fine. Socrates gets, you know, set free. But, of course, Socrates being Socrates, he can't. He's like that person that just can't live it. You know, it's like in the movies where, you know, they're getting in a fight with somebody, and the other people are walking off, and there's that one guy or gal who was just yelling at them, you know, and start it all up again. So Socrates starts it all up again. Now, what he says to them is that he would rather die than do what they expect of him. They expect him to, you know, plead and beg and parade his wife and children, and he says he's not gonna do that. Why not? Well, what he claims is this. It's impossible to avoid death. Everybody's going to die. The only thing that's in his power to avoid, because he's going to die eventually, is being unrighteous, being a bad person. And so his choice is going to be, since he has no choice about death, his choice is going to be to not be bad. And so essentially he's insulting them. Then, of course, he makes a prophecy, because all good stories have a prophecy. And he says that the people putting him to death are making a mistake, because by killing people, they can't prevent their own misdeeds from being, you know, brought to light. And this, you know, applies as well today. You know, we don't kill people as much today. But the idea being that if we silence people or punish them or, you know, shut down the press, that eventually will still come out. And he says correctly, the best way to avoid, you know, being seen as bad is just don't be bad, simple enough. Now, and he refers to his voice again. He says he knows he's doing the right thing because the voice never says, you know, stop, Socrates. Now, he then turns to his friends to try to console them. And he presents a really bad argument. But here's how it goes. This argument is what's called a dilemma. In a dilemma in philosophy, it's, well, in normal life, what's a dilemma? When someone says, facing a dilemma, what is it?
It's a problem.
Yeah, it's a problem. And, you know, by, you know, its very nature, it involves typically like two choices. And the person usually is trying to figure out between the two. Now, philosophically, a dilemma is this. You've got two options. You know, you've got an if P, then Q, P, then R, type of deal. So what's his dilemma? What are his two options? Well, he's trying to console his friends. You know, he's going to be sentenced to death, and his friends are like, Socrates, what are you doing? He says, don't worry. He says, there's two possibilities for death. One is, as other philosophers have said, death is nothingness. You cease to be. And previous philosophers had said, if you cease to be, there's nothing to fear, because you won't be there to fear anything. So if you're not, you have nothing to worry about. You can't suffer if you don't exist. The other option is basically a heaven-like place, he imagines. Now, if death is a state of nothing, he claims it's an unspeakable gain, because it's like, you just cease to exist, no suffering, all the pain's gone, you know, great. Second, If you go off to like heaven, that's pretty sweet too. Since those are the only two options, nothing to worry about. So what's wrong with his argument? Well, one standard criticism is that even though it's a legitimate dilemma, you know, you have two options and both of them are good, lead to good things, so there's nothing to worry about. But the problem lies in the two options. Namely, are those the only two possibilities? Either you go to heaven or nothing, or just you cease to exist. Could other things happen? For example, in most religions, is it just, hey, you die, you go to heaven, no matter what?
No.
No, the other option is, yeah, which is very bad. Yeah, so there could be, it could be, you know, there's hell. Or there could be many other options. You know, there's reincarnation. One of the, not as bad as hell, but in a way kind of creepier, there was an old episode of Tales from the Crypt, which is HBO, originally was a comic long ago, and then became an HBO, back when HBO made shorter stuff. They would have basically horror, short horror stories. They had the Crypt Keeper, which is like an animatronic thing, which was, seemed like it was on really weird drugs or something, whatever dead things would use for drugs. I'm guessing bodily fluid or Twinkies. Or maybe both. And one of the episodes was, you know, pretty creepy. The sort of the idea behind it was that when you died, you were still conscious and aware and could still feel, but you were still in your body. And so you'd just be laying there, and it told the story from the perspective of the corpse. And then, of course, the end scene is, you know, the person can totally still feel and everything, even though they can't move, and it shows the bone saw coming down for the autopsy. And I was like, that's pretty awful. Then, of course, the implication is that eventually the body just thrown in the grave and just lays there, you know, being devoured by worms and stuff, feeling it all. And that's pretty awful. So if that's one of the options, death would be something to fear. Yeah, so it seems that Socrates committed what's called the fallacy of false dilemma, presenting two choices as if there are only two, but there's more. So why would someone as wise as Socrates commit such a basic fallacy? Well, why do parents tell their kids that their drawing is great art, even though it's just like crayon scribbles? Yeah, because they love their kids. And they're not going to tell their kids, you know, they're going to be honest with their kids and say, that's crap, you know, that's horrible. They're going to tell them it's great. And it could be that he's trying to console his friends, so his goal is not to make a logically strong argument, but basically so they're not going to worry. Now, he does claim that he does think he has nothing to worry about, because he claims that nothing evil can happen to a good person, and he has nothing to worry about. His time has come, the oracle knows that this is not bad, and so he's not worried. Now, of course, what I would reply is this. He's about to be sent off to death, so why is that not evil? Well, Socrates' view is that he's going to die anyways. You know, so death is not an evil thing. His view is that them killing him is not like an evil happening to him. Because what would be evil would be as if he, you know, became bad, if he decided to, you know, go back on his word. So he thinks that, and this is, you know, kind of an odd view for most people, he thinks that being killed is not like an evil that happens to him. Because as long as he stays good, then that's fine. So in the end, he asks a favor of his friends to make sure that his sons, if they were too interested in wealth or power, that they, you know, trouble his sons. And he, you know, says at the end that the time to leave has arrived, and he goes to death, they to live, and then the curtain falls. And then, of course, they have the end credit with Socrates and Iron Man eating sandwiches. Some sort of store, then, you know, I guess Matt Damon shows up or something, however that goes. Now, Socrates, of course, eventually in the Crito, his friends show up and say, you know, bribe the guards, we're going to bust you up. And Socrates being Socrates, says, well, let's consider if this would be the right thing to do. And he ends up arguing that since he gave his word to the state, he has to stay and die. And he does. So what happened to his accusers? Well, his prophecy came true. They all eventually met terrible, terrible ends, and they were all killed. So his words came true. Of course, Plato wrote this after he knew that happened, so prophecies after the fact. And so that's the end of our good dead friend, Socrates. Before heading into part two, and so ends part one, anything about Socrates that needs more sock? Okay, now we transition into part two. So all the quizzes for part one and exam one, they cover up to there. And so now we transition to part two, and the stuff we'll start talking about now is covered by the quizzes for part two and, of course, exam two. So be sure to finish the quizzes for part one by this near Friday. I just put it on Friday because, you know, convenient. And for exam number one, you may want to do it, you have to do it by June 1st. You may want to do it before while the stuff is still kind of fresh and we haven't moved on to the more stuff. But you have until June 1st to do the exam for part one. Because now we have to part two, philosophy and religion. Now, we pick up a short while after the death of Socrates. Now, as you might know, of course, that Christianity arises out of, you know, Jewish tradition and Greek thought. Now, one of the core problems in the West, Western religion, also Islam as well, is the problem of faith and reason. Now, the ancient Greeks didn't have so much of this problem because their religion was kind of like, you know, based on, you know, their poetry and so forth. And the Greek philosophers tended to be, as they're often accused of being, kind of atheistic. I mean, they would kind of acknowledge the gods. Socrates, for example, was well known for swearing by the dog, Anubis, Egyptian god of the dead. That is like his favorite god, apparently. And of course, in the Jewish tradition, the view is that they are God's chosen people. Now, in Christianity, and later in Islam, you get this conflict between faith and reason really rolling. In large part because, interestingly enough, both Christianity and Islam trace their origin story back to, this would seem kind of odd, but it's quite true, back to Greek and Roman philosophy. And during the Middle Ages, many Christian, Jewish, and Islamic scholars spent a lot of time doing philosophy. And much of our, you know, current philosophical heritage comes from, you know, thinkers in the Middle East and, of course, in the West, developing these ideas. So here's the challenge. Both philosophy and religion try to answer the big question, namely, what is the meaning of life, the universe, and everything? And so they deal with the same basic questions. So what's the difference? Well, religion ultimately, of course, embraces faith. And philosophy, of course, ultimately embraces reason. Now, so there's a lot of classic questions here, like, can you believe faith? Can you trust reason? What do you do when faith and reason seem to conflict? Now, interestingly, if you go back in Christian thought, there are many points of disagreement. Namely, in Plato and Aristotle, for example, you don't have God. In Aristotle, you don't have a personal immortality. But they do have some agreement. In Plato, of course, you have, as we'll see in part three, you have a transcendent world with the forms, you have objective morality, etc. Interestingly, if you go through the Bible, the New Testament, you see quite a few references to philosophers. Some of it anti-philosophical, some of it pro-philosophical. In large part because during the Roman Empire, Christianity was a pretty minor faith, back, you know, often persecuted, and they were competing with Greek and Roman philosophy. So they had to engage with those philosophical views, and so you actually see references in the Bible to the Stoics and Epicureans, etc.
Now, one of the things that later happened, you know, jumping ahead to the 11th and 12th century, you had a conflict, faith and reason, within the faith itself. Some thinkers believe that reason should be dominant. This includes John Scotus Erigena, the famous Rosellan, the famous Abelard, and then there were those who favored faith, the namely Peter Damian, Saint Bernard, not the dog, but the guy. And then along came the person we'll look at, our good dead friend, St. Elson. And he had this view. He believed that reason and faith would lead you to the same place, that every view of Christianity could be proved through deductive logic, he claimed. Now then later, we get our good dead friend, St. Thomas Aquinas, who a lot of high schools are named, and he developed a synthesis of both reason and faith. Now, this stuff is important, of course, historically, but also important today, because we still do have the conflict between faith and reason. Now, one big question in metaphysics, also a question in religion, obviously enough, is the question of God. Now, most people make the classic mistake of leaping to the second question first, rather than asking the first question first. And the second question, metaphysical question, is this: does God exist? And of course, this is usually put in the form of, do you believe in God? And eventually, I get reluctant to tell people I was a philosophy professor, like, if I run into random people, like, especially when I'm trapped and I'm playing with them for like a couple hours, because that can go bad really, really quick, and then you're stuck with them. And people would ask me, like, do you believe in God? And I, of course, would say back, what do you mean by God? And they're like, what? I'm like, what do you mean by God? And they're like, you know, God, the, you know, God. And I'm like, what do you mean? And they said, well, it's just God. And I said, well, there are different interpretations of God. There's the God of the Old Testament, the God of the New Testament. There's the God that, you know, supposedly hates homosexuals. There's the God who's okay with homosexuals. The God who tells us not to eat any pork. The God who says pork is okay. So which one are we talking about here? Like, you know, they just say, you know, God. Now, the reason why, and I'm just being a smartass at that point, I'm actually serious. And the reason why is this, is because we have the term God, and we think we know what it means, but we don't know what it means. Because if people ask the question, does God exist, they're not even really sure what they're asking. What do we mean by God? So before we can ask, does God exist, we have to know what we're asking about. Namely, what is the nature of God? What are we talking about? Now, the usual answer, of course, is that God is all good, all powerful, and all knowing, you know, supreme being. And then, if you accept that, then you can go to the question of does that exist? But of course, even then, there's debates about what is it to be all powerful. For example, centuries ago, when I first started teaching philosophy, we covered God, and it brought up like how God is supposed to be all powerful. And I had said, well, I think, you know, all powerful means you can do anything that can be done. I remember very vividly a student said, no, that's not powerful enough. She said, God must be able to do anything, even the impossible. And I said, well, how would God do that? How can God do the impossible? Because it's not possible. And the person said, in God, all things are possible. God can do anything, even the impossible. And then I would say, like, well, how can you mean, like, you can make a triangle with five sides and still be a triangle with three sides, but have five sides at the same time. How would that work? They're like, well, I don't know, but God can do it. And that's a view people have, that being all powerful means God can do anything, even the impossible. And he can make a triangle five-sided. It's not that we'd call five-sided figures triangles, if that the three-sided figure would be five-sided, but also, but three-sided and five-sided. I have no idea how that would work, but it would. Similarly, 2 + 2 could be 7. It's not that we'd call 4 7, it's that adding 2 and 2 would give you 7. I have no idea how that would work, because it's impossible, but if God was all-powerful in that sense, he could do it. And so even if you think, you know, like, God is all-powerful, there's a question of the limits of that power. You might have heard the classic riddle, can God make a rock he cannot lift? Because, and it's a paradox, because if you say no, because he can lift anything, that means that he is limited, because he can't make a rock he himself can't lift. But if he can make a rock he can't lift, then he's also limited because he can't lift it. So either way, there to be a limit on that power. And so debating about, you know, what we mean by God being all-powerful. You know, so if someone says, do you believe in God? And I say, what do you mean by omnipotence? Usually that shuts them up. They stop talking to me. They start drinking. Drinking at it. Stewardess, more booze. I'm stuck next to a philosopher. They're like, oh, I'm sorry. All your alcohol is complimentary. It's actually a clause. Most airlines have that. If you're stuck next to a philosopher, just ask for alcohol. Legally, they have to bring you free alcohol until you are unconscious or don't want it anymore. It's the law. And a sensible law as well. Another thing, of course, is God being all-knowing. Now, if you're all-knowing, what do you know? Yeah, you know all the things. But of course, there's still a question there about, lots of questions about how much is all the things. So, can God know the future? On one hand, you know, you might say, well, he has to, because he knows everything. You know, God knows the future. But then, of course, there's a problem, because if God knows the future, that means that he knows everything you're going to do, so you really... you think maybe you don't have any free choice, because God always knows what you're going to do. Now, there is a clever workaround on that. St. Augustine says, or said because he's dead, that God exists in a way that he can perceive all of time. So for us, there's a past, present, and future, because we live in time. So our future hasn't arrived yet. But God, he sees it all. It's like being able to get the DVD and see the whole, you know, he's got the book, and he can, you know, flip anywhere in the book and see what's going on. But we have to live in the book. We can only go along a sentence at a time. And so God knows what you're going to do, because from his standpoint, you already did done it, to combine past and future and present tense. So for God, there is no past, present, or future. There's just all that there is. And so he doesn't make you do stuff. You're free to do what you do, but he already knows what you're going to do, because from his standpoint, you've already done it. Yeah, so there is that question about God, you know, being all knowing. And of course, when we say God is all good, there's also questions about that. What do we mean by being pure good? What does that mean? So question number one is, when we're talking about God, what are we talking about? And as we'll see, there are some thinkers, like Blaise Pascal, who claim we can't answer this. We can have no idea. So we can never answer this question either. So if you really want to annoy people, if they ask you to believe in God, just ask them, what do you mean by the nature of God? Now, the second set of questions are epistemic questions, questions about what we can know. Question one is, how do we know the nature of God? So if someone claims to know what God wants, and people have all kinds of claims of what God wants. Some people claim that God doesn't want us to eat pork. Some people claim that God opposes same-sex marriage. Some claim that God hates Western education. Some claim that God hates YouTube. That's probably true. It probably does. And so when people put off forth all these claims, a good question is, how do they know? Which is a fair point. And we'll see address some of that. Then there's a question, of course, how do we know if God actually exists? What would be the proof? Now, historically, approaching these questions, these two sets of questions, have involved two main approaches. One camp is reason and logic can help. The other camp is can't help. Now, within the reason and logic can help, there are two big divisions, two factions. The first faction, and it's a faction that cuts across all of philosophy, are what are called the a priori folks. They're typically called rationalists. And what they believe is this. They believe you can know about God a priori, which of course is Latin for before. Good question is, for what? Well, here's the definition. A priori reasoning, broadly speaking, is this. It is when you reason about stuff by pure reason. You don't bring in empirical evidence. There's no empirical observations. You don't have to go look to see if it's true. And I'll do a stupid example. I have drawn a triangle on the board. How many sides does it have? How did you know? I've covered. You are correct, but how did you know? Yeah, it's the nature of triangles. I mean, I could be lying about, you know, whether I drew or not, but if I drew a triangle, it's got to have three sides. You don't have to look. You know it a priori, because if something's a triangle, it's got three sides. Now, that's the sort of a priori reasoning that all philosophers accept. You know, there's some things that you just know by pure definition. Or another example, if someone truly is a bachelor, are they married? No. Because by definition, they're not. Yeah, they're single. Now, what makes the a priori camp special, though, is not that they think there are some things you can know by a priori mean, because everyone thinks that. They believe that you can know about things that exist by pure reason. That you can just sort of think through a proof and know that something exists. And this, of course, is most commonly done in the case of God. We'll look at St. Anselm, Descartes, and Leibniz, and they believe you can just kind of sit down in your chair thinking about it, and you can prove by pure logic that God exists. Now, this also extends beyond God. There's a broader question of, can you prove that things exist by pure reasoning, by pure mathematics? So could you sit down, like as a physicist, and work out the equations and prove, without doing any observations, that something exists? I mean, it may seem kind of crazy, but it's something that's done today. For example, one thing that was once, you know, part of science fiction and philosophy, the idea that there are other worlds, not like other planets, but other dimensions, other realities. And physicists take that seriously now. But can we travel to them? Can we see them? Can we say, oh yeah, there's another other reality? Typically no, except in sci-fi. And so the only way we can know they exist is by doing like mathematics. And the idea is by pure mathematics, you can prove there are such things. Now, some scientists claim that you can actually observe their effect, like they have some impact on this world. Well, I mean, which is possible. If you've seen sci-fi shows or, you know, superhero shows, they do have, one way they sell more comics, both DC and Marvel do this, is an alternative timeline. You know, there's like a world where Spider-Man is Hispanic, or Thor is a woman, or things turned out differently. And it's a way to sell, you know, sell more comics. And so, you know, there may be ways, at least, you know, sci-fi, where you could travel to other worlds. Yeah, I guess there are other worlds I can see the stuff. So recapping, a priori reasoning is when using just pure reason, without any experience or observation, you're able to establish something or prove it to be true. Real world examples would be things like geometry, algebra, logical proofs. You don't have to go and empirically show, you don't observe like add two things and you get four, you do the proof mathematically. People who believe this include Saint Anselm, Descartes, and Leibniz. Now also often going along with this is a notion of what's called innate ideas. Now if something is innate, what does that mean?
You're born.
Yeah, you're born that way. It's not Maybelline, you're in fact born that way. Remember that old commercial. And so innate ideas are supposedly like preloaded. To use an analogy. Back in the old days of computing, back in the day of my first computer was a Commodore 64, which is actually a pretty cool computer because it could play games and stuff. Now, when you turned it on, plugged it into your TV and turned it on, all you get was a little flashing cursor because it had no operating system and nothing. If you wanted to do anything, you had to either load a program. At first, they had a tape recorder that you'd load programs off tapes. Eventually, they developed disk drive technology. Or you could type it in yourself. So it couldn't do anything until you loaded stuff in. But today, when you buy like a smartphone or a laptop or a tablet, it's already got all kinds of stuff in there. You know, they're preloaded in the factory. So to use the metaphor, innate ideas are like preloaded programs and apps that when you're born, you don't have them, you don't learn them, they're built in. And people like Descartes and Leibniz believed in them. They typically include, well, not surprisingly, for people like Descartes and Leibniz, the idea of God is built in. It's like in your folder. Also, often things like mathematics and geometry are supposed to be built in. Now, our second main camp is the a posteriori camp. These folks are known as empiricists. It comes from the term empirical. Empirical means what? Everybody talked about the empirical sciences. They mean the science of stuff we can
learn.
Yeah, learn by seeing observations. So the a posteriori reasoning is reasoning that's based on stuff after experience, things that you've observed with your senses or instruments. And a good example would be, when you use like an argument by analogy or an argument by example. Those are a posteriori reasoning because they're basing them on observations and experiments. Now, people who believe in a priori reasoning also believe in a posteriori reasoning as well, at least sometimes. What makes these folks distinct, though, the empiricists, is they reject this central view, the view that you can know about stuff existing by pure reason. The empiricists say the only way you know something exists is by experience. So the rationalists say you can know something exists by pure reason. You sit down and think and say, aha, I know God exists. The empiricists say that's BS. If you want to know that God exists, you've got to start with empirical evidence and then argue from there. Otherwise, you don't know. As you might imagine, this is where empirical science lives. The idea that you gotta trace it back to an observation. It could be like with a telescope or whatever, but it's got to go to some observation. Now these folks, they reject innate ideas. Instead, they embrace this concept of tabula rasa, which is a well-known term in psychology. Anyone know this? Perhaps from a psychology class? A literal translation or close translation would be blank slate. the idea being that once you're born, your mind is empty. And so whatever is in here, according to the empiricist, has to come from out there through the senses. To use an analogy, for the rationalist, if the mind is like a computer preloaded with stuff, for the empiricist, the mind is like that computer I was telling you about, where it's just, you get a blank, you know, get nothing in there. So everything that's in there has to be put in there. Example of famous empiricists include St. Thomas Aquinas, David Hume, John Locke, and a lot of other people living and dead. So our first main camp is people think reason and logic can help us with questions about God. This splits into two subgroups, those who believe in a priori reasoning, the rationalists, who think you can prove God's existence by pure reason. A posteriori reasoning, people who think you can prove or disprove God not by pure reason, pure logic, but you have to begin with empirical evidence. Before moving on, anything about this? It needs more. Now, if one camp is we can use logic, the other obvious contender is, nope, none of that logic and stuff. So, if you can't use logic and reason, what would be the alternatives? Well, one thing, of course, is just pure faith. And faith is believing. Yeah, just believing. You just do, you know. Because if it's known by faith, you don't have reasons for it. You just believe. There can also be like a mystical experience, divine revelation, where you don't argue for God's existence. You have an experience that just reveals it to you. There's also the view that you just can't know God. There's just no way, like a skeptical position. There's no way to know at all. And then lastly, we'll have a pretty strange approach. We'll see Pascal's wager. And his view is, you can't know whether God exists or not, but God is your best bet. And we'll see this at the end of this part. Before pressing on, anything about this needs more stuff. So how do people argue about God? Well, here's some more stuff for the, your argumentation toolbox and conceptual toolbox. Now, we already have one of these tools, namely the reduction to absurdity, but we're going to add two more tools and concepts to your philosophical toolkit, namely the circular regress and the infinite regress. And these are both bad things to be caught in, but as we'll see, you can use them to fuel or power a reductio argument. So first is this. The circular regress, so named because you end up being caught in a circle. In a way, you can think of them as kind of like traps. If you ever saw a Doctor Strange movie, spoilers if you haven't seen it, but at the end, he's got like a time loop going, and the idea is like you're trapped and repeating the same thing over and over. And if you're stuck in that, that's like pretty bad. Now, circular regress works like this. The idea is that A requires, B, B requires C, Z requires A, or the most simple one is A requires itself. To give a concrete example, everyone's always heard the saying that in order to get a job, you got to have experience. But in order to have experience, you got to have a job. Now, if that were true, it would be your circular regress. Because jobs require experience requires job, and you'd never be able to get either. It'd be an unbreakable circle, which means no one would be working at all. But clearly people are, so clearly the circle is breakable. So a circular regress just runs you in a circle. And again, it could be like a super, you know, super small circle. A requires A, in which case, you know, you get nowhere. Or it could be a, you know, it could be a much bigger circle. But the idea is, it always and eventually takes you, you know, back to the beginning. So you're running in a circle. And the reason that is bad is, well, if you're running in a circle, how long will it take you to get, say, from here to California?
Forever.
Yeah, forever. Because you used to be running in a circle. You'd go, you're effectively going nowhere. Yeah, so circular regress is bad. If you can show that somebody gets in a circular regress, that is bad for them. In computer programming, this essentially is an infinite loop. If you ever, back in the ancient days when they had BASIC, you'd have, you know, 10, print, oh, 20, go to 10. And that would be an infinite, you know, that'd be a circular, because you just keep running, you go from 10, and you just keep going in a circle. And this, of course, would print a low forever on the screen. Yeah, back when I was in school, the computers had nothing on them, so you had to program them yourself. And so anybody could get in and program them. And people did terrible, terrible things, of course. Which is probably why the only people do that anymore, thanks to my generation. We ruined everything. You're welcome for that. But your turn's coming up. You get to ruin everything for future generations, too. And they will thank you. No, they won't. They'll resent it, just like you resent what we did. But then we'll die. We escape. That's how we escape. And that's how you'll escape too. That's how it goes. You ruin things, you die, and they get their chance to ruin things. Yes, circular regress is bad. So what about the infinite regress? Now, someone who knows geometry will say, wait, circles are infinite. So why isn't the circular regress infinite? And the answer is, of course, yeah, technically it is infinite, but it's a different type of infinity. Now, the infinite regress, as distinct from the circular regress, works like this. Instead of running in a circle infinitely, that is that one thing requires another, requires another, requires another, and this goes on to infinity or beyond, but it never actually loops back. So instead of it, you know, curving back so that 4 requires 1, which would be circular, 4 requires 5, 5 requires 6, and so on to infinity. So there's always a new requirement, and you never move back. So this one, you're infinitely going in a circle. It's like that, your programming loop. And this one is basically like not, it's having like an addition that never ends. Now the problem is, if you can show that something, one thing requires another, requires another, requires another, requires another, requires another, this ends up being bad because you can never get this, because this always requires something else to infinity. This has been around in philosophy for a long time. There's a fellow called Zeno, which is kind of a cool name, and he came up with these famous paradoxes. And one of them,
you've been reading for some time.
One of them, well, actually, many of them rest on this idea of infinite regress. And the most famous one, is the paradox of motion, which is this. In order for me to go from here to the desk, I have to cover half the distance, obviously. I'd be at halfway before I can go the full way. Now, of course, to get to the halfway point, I have to get halfway to the halfway point. But to get halfway to the halfway point, I have to get halfway to the halfway of the halfway point. And of course, if we keep doing this, I have to cover an infinite amount of distance, because there's an infinite number of halfways I have to reach, which means that there can be no motion, because in order to reach the desk, I would have to cover an infinite amount of steps. But of course, I can't do that. I can never reach the desk. But yet I can. Now, the point of that was, by Zeno, was not to, you know, say you can't do what you can do, but he wanted to point out, you know, interestingly, that there are clear limits to reason, because, you know, logically, that's perfectly reasonable. If you have to take an infinite number of steps to get there, you can't do it. It's impossible. But clearly, we can. And Zeno actually had a whole bunch of problems and paradoxes. like that. And again, the best known one is that, that one about motion. Now, aside from like annoying people, what good are, you know, regresses? Well, and what would be an example of an infinite regress? Another one. Well, one you may have encountered is the evil bureaucrat example. Suppose you go to get financial aid. You go to the financial office and you say, I'd like some financial aid, please. And the person behind the desk says, but of course, we're from the government. We're here to help. All you have to do is fill out the form for requesting financial aid. You say, wow, that's cool. Can I have the form? And they say, but of course. I mentioned we're from the government. We're here to help, right? All you have to do to get the form to request financial aid is fill out the form for requesting the form for filling out, for getting financial aid. And say, for us, say, can I have that form, please? But of course, we're here to help. In order to get the form for requesting the form for requesting financial aid, all you have to do is fill out the form for requesting the form for requesting the form for requesting financial aid. And for every form, there's another form you have to fill out to get that form, which means you get your money never, because there's always another form. And that's why infinite regresses are bad, because you'll never, you know, that for example, you never get your money. So infinite regresses, bad. So the question then is, if they're bad, how can you use them? Well, there are many uses for bad things. Now, what you can use the circular regress or the infinite regress for is this. Since they lead to impossibilities and absurdities, they can fuel our argument that basically burns absurdities, which is reductio ad absurdum. Now, we saw this back in the ancient days of the beginning, but to quickly recap. Again, there's two versions. One is you want to disprove something. So what you do is you assume it's true, prove this assumption leads to something false, absurd, or contradictory, and of course, if it leads to a circular or infinite regress, that's an impossibility. So we show that it's false. Now you can also, of course, do the opposite. If you want to prove that something is true, you assume it's false, show that assuming it's false leads to an absurdity or contradiction, then show that it's true. Now, this is pretty powerful stuff. So if you can take an infinite regress and burn that to fuel your argument from absurdity, you can get some pretty, you know, intriguing results. To illustrate, I can prove, using only my Expo marker and this board, that there had to be a non-human origin to us. Easy to do. Now, how do we do this? Well, we'll use this reductio method, specifically this. We'll assume that every human has to have human parents. We'll assume that's true. And this will, amazingly enough, generate an infinite regress, a huge infinite regress. And here's how it goes. Now, at the start, it seems perfectly reasonable, because everybody's got human parents, unless you're an alien or something. And of course, their parents, each of us, our parents have human parents. And so on and so forth. Now, of course, it makes perfect sense. So how does the regress get going to show this is impossible? Well, if every parent has to have human parents, that means that you can never stop the regress. Because every person you put in the family tree, you've got to put how many more? Two more. And of course, for each of those, you have to put in two more. And for each of those, two more. So if every human has to have human parents, there has to be an infinite number of people, because for every human, you've got to put in two more people. Now, have there been an infinite number of people? And the answer is there can't be. It's impossible. So that means that either we don't exist, that we're all just the delusion of something, or that our origin had to be in something non-human. Now, this doesn't tell us what the origin point is. It just tells us that in order for us to be here, there had to be a first human who did not have human parents. Otherwise, we couldn't be here. So, what's the origin story for us? We've actually got...
apes?
Yeah, it could be, you know, you get the, you know, early primates. Of course, then you could run the same story with them. Namely, if every ape has to have an ape parents, you need two, and you have to go back beyond that. What's another part of another version of our origin story?
Adam and Eve.
Did they have human parents?
No.
No, so they didn't have belly buttons. Adam and Eve didn't have belly buttons. They would, because they weren't born. They were created. Unless God decided to give them belly buttons just, you know, for fun. And so, yeah, they were created by God, not human parents, and so they exist that way. Yeah, and so the two big stories are typically religious ones. We're created by divine beings, or we're created by, you know, ultimately the Big Bang. And then you get, like, you know, slime and lizard-like things, and primates, that else. Yeah, so quite easily we can prove that we had to have a non-human origin. So all of us have some sort of non-human starting point. Could be Adam and Eve, could be the Big Bang, could be many things. You know, we have many origin stories. Or maybe it's some kind of weird time travel thing, you know, like in sci-fi. So that's the way we can refuel these regressive arguments into the absurdity arguments, getting the result. Now, as you might imagine, as this indicated, this does show points away towards arguing for God, which in fact is what many philosophers do. Okay, so important stuff here is the circular regress, which of course is running in a circle forever. There is, of course, the regress, where you have the infinite requirements, and then the reductio ad absurdum. And again, what you basically do is if you can show that assuming something leads to a circular regress, then that's got to be a problem. Before pressing on to our next exciting slide, anything about the stuff so far? Needs more stuff. Okay, we now turn to our first philosopher looking at philosophy and religion, namely our good dead friend Sun Hudson, born in 1033, died in 1109, and eventually became a saint. Now, a saint's a pretty good job, except for one serious problem. In order to be a saint, you gotta be...
good and...
yes, both. Good and dead. Yeah, because you gotta be, you know, appropriately, you know, good and appropriately dead. So if there's ever like a job application for sainthood, let's think about that second part, the dead part. Or they might ask you, like, they might say, you know, do you have any problems relocating, or do you have any problems with being dead? You know, you're willing to really come, relocate, and be dead, saying that could be an option. Now, Anselm believed, one of his sort of signature things is, he believed that by pure reason, he could prove all the truths of Christianity. What is interesting for a couple reasons. One is the idea that you could prove everything through deductive logic, and of course the idea that you could do this for religion. Now, a good question might be, if you actually are a believer, why would you care about proving what you believe?
Because other people are going to question it, like your belief?
Yeah. You want to be able to convince other people you're right. And of course you might also want to know that you're right, just to be sure. And so as Anselm saw it, he believed that faith could lead you to the absolute truth, but he believed that, you know, oh, by the way, we can also prove this with deductive logic. What made him famous philosophically was his ontological argument. Putting him in our camps, he's in the camp of reason can prove God's existence, and in the subcampo, the rationalists, the a priori gods. So Anselm believed that you could just sit down and think about God, and by thinking about it without even looking, no peeking, you could prove that God exists. So a good question to be is, how can he do this? Well, here's what he does. He begins by bringing forth the fool. And the fool was kind of a standard character used in religious philosophy for a stand-in for someone who had doubts about God. And one reason to do this, of course, is when you're writing in a time where they could like nail you to something and set you on fire for believing the wrong thing, you want to be pretty careful about, like, when you're writing about any doubts about God. You always want to attribute those to the fool. And of course, if someone was sincerely a believer, they would think that only fools would believe otherwise. Now, the way he gets the argument rolling is this. He's got to define God, and he believes from the a priori definition, just thinking about it, he can define God, and he believes that from that definition, he can prove God exists. Now, an interesting question might be, well, how can you prove anything just by definition? Well, I can go back to my triangle example. If we define triangles as having three sides, then how many sides must triangles have? Yeah, three. Gotta have three. And so we can kind of prove stuff by definition. Now, of course, you may think that's a cheat, because we're just saying they got three sides, so they got three sides. So maybe it is kind of a cheat. So here's how Anselm does it. He's got the fool, and the fool is a fool, as we see, because the fool doubts God exists. But what he's going to do is kind of Socratize the fool and show that even by the fool's own, you know, reasoning, the fool's got to be the fool. They got to be wrong. So he says this. We got the fool symbolized by the dunce cap. Interestingly, another bit of trivia, the term dunce means what? Yeah, someone's stupid. Now, interestingly, the origin story of dunce comes from John Duns Scotus, and his followers called themselves duncemen, or dunces. Now, you may be thinking, why would someone call themselves, you know, fools or idiots? Well, they didn't. But later on, the reformers, academic reformers, they looked at the followers of John Duns Scotus as sort of, you know, hidebound and, you know, not willing to accept, you know, truths. And so they regarded the term dunce or duncemen as an insult. And it got passed down from that time period, the medieval insult, to sticking today. So it actually goes back hundreds of years, and it's over a philosophical dispute, interestingly enough. It's kind of like how today, if someone calls you a liberal, is that a bad thing? Like if you're on a, you know, debating on online, someone calls you a liberal or a libtard. Is libtard a good thing? No. No. And so the term liberal, they're trying to turn into like a bad term. And so someday, maybe, you know, 100 years from now, they might be talking about one time being a liberal meant accepting leftist political views. Now it means being an idiot. I guess they would look like this. They would have the big L hat for liberal. Mm-hmm. And also a loser. So it's interesting how words kind of stick. Now, the fool, symbolized by the dunce cap, does accept this, the definition of God. So Anselm defines God as a being than which nothing greater can be conceived, which is wrong. People often sort of condense it down to, you know, God being perfect, just so they don't say that over and over again. So what I'll do, since I don't say that over and over again, I'll jump typically to say perfect. But when I say perfect, I mean this. I'm just saying that because I don't want to just keep saying a being that which nothing greater can be conceived. Now, the fool accepts the definition. So if you say to the fool, do you understand what God is? And the fool would say, got it, a being that which nothing greater can be conceived. But the fool says, there is no God. So how does Anselm get from the fool understanding the definition to the fool being wrong?
Well, we'll
see how this plays out. So the fool understands it, and the fool therefore accepts that in his understanding, is this notion of God. Now, Anselm points out correctly that there is a difference between something to exist as an object of your understanding and for something to exist for real. And he gives the example of a painting. There is a, you know, the painter pictures the painting before and then creates it. It's one thing to be in your mind, another to be painted out there for real. Now, is he right about that? Is there a difference between in your mind and out there? Probably. Unless there's no external world, in which case, no. So at this point, the fool accepts the definition. The fool accepts he's got the idea of God existing in his understanding. So the question would be, the fool's probably thinking, okay, yeah, I get all that, but what's the point? Well, here's what happens. Anselm notes that if we understand something, it's in our understanding. You know, roughly put, if we're thinking about it, it's in our mind. And here's where he does either a brilliant bit of logic or a brilliant bit of trickery. Here's how it goes. He claims that what is called God cannot just exist in your understanding. Why? Well, here's why. If it's just in your understanding, but not existing for real, then it is not that which nothing greater can be conceived. Why not? Well, here's why not, according to him. If God was just here in your mind and didn't exist out here, you can easily think of something greater than this, namely this existing for real. So, if God only existed in our mind and not for real, God wouldn't be God, because God is that which nothing greater can be conceived. So if he didn't exist for real, but just in our mind, there would be something greater than God, namely God existing for real. So God has to be real. Crudely put, he's roughly saying that since God is perfect, there's nothing greater than God, he's got to exist. Because if he didn't exist, he wouldn't be perfect. But he is, so he's got to exist. Now, what this hinges on is that what's out there for real is greater than what's in your mind. So is he right about that? Well, let's try an analogy. Which is greater, a dollar in your hand or $1 million in your mind? Yeah. I mean, suppose you went to the, you know, went to the bank and said, I'd like you to deposit $1 million. And I'm sure they'd be pretty excited. They're like, oh, yes, right this way, sir. And I'd said, okay, I'm thinking $1 million, now deposit it. They would think I was, you know, they would call the police. They'd think I was insane. Because the idea of $1 million is enough. Yeah, so the idea of something is less than the thing itself. And so Anselm seems to be right. So the way this kind of works, again, is on the definition of God. God is defined as, if you can think of something greater than this, it's not God. So if God was just in your mind, you can think of something greater than just your idea of God, and that, of course, would be God. So God's got to exist for we, or so he claims. Now, you'd think that at that point, Anselm would be satisfied. Okay, he's proven that God's got to exist. you know, good day work, you know, it's Miller time. Is Miller time still a thing? I'm using, like, you know, jingles and things from when I was younger, which is a long time ago, back in the dinosaur age. They used to brew Miller Lite out of dinosaurs. They still do that? It's like a dinosaurs? I mean, me, besides me. Now, you'd think at this point he would say, okay, I proved God, you know, it's Miller time, done. But no, he wants to do more. Specifically this. He wants to say, not only does God have to exist, you can't even think of God not existing. Can't even do that. How can he make this argument? Well, this is what he claims. You can think of a being that you cannot think of as not existing. I mean, that's pretty complicated. And that, of course, is greater than one you can think of as non-existent. I mean, roughly put, he's saying, imagine a being that, you know, is super, cannot be destroyed. That being is greater than a being that can be destroyed. That seems true. Now, if we can think of God and think of God not existing, there's still something greater, namely God that we can't think of as not existing. So, in order for God to be God, you know, the greatest being, we can't even think of God not existing. Because if we could think of God not existing, we could think of something greater, namely God that we can't think of as not existing. Again, kind of weird, but given his logic, that seems to follow. So he claims, bless you, not only do we have to accept that God exists, because God's God, we can't even think of God not existing. Otherwise, we'd be engaged in a contradiction. Now, at this point, you think, surely now it must be Miller time for Sam Anselm, because he's proven God exists. He's proven we can't even think that God doesn't exist. But no, not enough. If you call before midnight, you'll throw in a third thing. And the third thing is this. This only applies to God. He doesn't want, like, this applying to other stuff. So why does it only apply to God? Well, here's his reasoning. If we could think of a being better than God, then the created, the creature of the created, would be greater than the creator, which would be, he claims, absurd. So, everything other than God, we can think of as non-existent. Why? Well, part of this is because he thinks, going back to an old notion stolen from Plato, that God exists more truly than everything else, and in a higher degree. Now, today, typically, we think of existence as what? Either something exists or it did or doesn't. But for medieval and ancient thinkers, there are like degrees of reality. Something could be more real or less real. Probably the best way to think of this is like in games, like where they have levels of things, like you level up your character and stuff. And the idea is that God has got the highest level. He's like max level. And reality is like having those levels. So God is, you know, the highest level. Godhood. Now he claims that everything else that exists in a lesser way, than God. So God, you know, got three things going. One, he's got to exist. And the first part of the argument is, well, if God is the greatest being, he can't just be an idea, because you can think of something greater, namely God for real. So God's got to exist. Then he says, that's not enough. You can't even think of God not existing, because if you're thinking of God not existing, you're not really thinking of God, because a being that must exist, that can't not exist, is greater than one that can not exist. Finally, he says, this only applies to God, nothing else. because God is the greatest, the highest reality. So why does the fool deny God? Because the fool is a fool. Okay, so next time we'll look at a refutation of this from our good dead friend Danilo, and then a refutation by St. Anselm. So good rest of Wednesday. I'll see you all on Thursday.